Hi. My name is Gerald Mücker, and I like to talk today about reactive data analysis with Vertex. Short about me, I'm a self-employed consultant, so I have my own little company. I focus on quality assurance, performance testing, tools, operation, and some operational topics like application performance monitoring and monitoring in general. Okay, the data analysis is a little bit about big data. I looked it up on Wikipedia, and it is characterized by five characteristics. One is the volume. You have lots of data that's already in the big. You have a variety of data. We have to process the data in a specific velocity. You have certain variability in the data and the veracity. In today's talk, I concentrate on the velocity aspect, a little bit on the volume. So how to process the data in a fast way and to use a library for this, like Vertex, for instance. Okay. So fast data processing. What are the sources of the data? It can be a database, file in the file system, and of course network. I don't talk about streaming, how to process network data here, because it's kind of an own topic. Yeah, so the idea for this talk came when I was working at a customer, and the customer did some automated test runs over a year, and they stored their time measurements of their test executions in a MongoDB database. So it's kind of lots of data, lots of sampling data there. And these time series data had all a timestamp and a value, but no proper visualization. They built their own thing using something with Angular. And it had really scalability problems. Like it was loading all the data sets that match all the data that matched the query into the memory, tried to process it and render a graph from it, inserting 0 points when there was no data. You probably cannot see it, it's on the bottom line. So it was not really good, not very scalable. And yeah, I tried to look up alternative ways for processing the data they have collected. So first, I have to want to explain what time series data is. Pretty simple. It's a set of data points with a timestamp and a value. That's it. So you can align them on a time axis and put it on a y axis to sort of display them. Okay, MongoDB. Who hasn't? For those of you who haven't heard of it, it's a NoSQL database with a focus on scale. Has a JSON as data representation, or BSON, which is binary JSON, and then for transmitting and storing the data. Itself has no HTTP endpoint. It uses a TCP-based wire protocol. I think in the latest release of their cloud-based solutions, they have some sort of HTTP endpoint, but not for the standalone one. And it has an aggregation framework for more complex queries. It's sort of SQL-like possibilities. And what's also kind of important, we come to this later, they were one of the first databases that provided an asynchronous driver. For visualizing the data, I didn't want to build something new. I want to reuse what was already there. There's a framework called Grafana. It's a service for visualizing time series data. It's open source. The backend is written in Go. The frontend based on Angular. And you can create nice dashboards from it. Who of you has already used Grafana? OK, some know it. OK. It's pretty easy to use. Grafana has the possibility to write your own data source plugins, but they are all plugins for the Angular UI. They're not run on the backend. The backend only is for storing settings and providing a proxy when you cannot access the data source directly. And with all this Angular data source, so the only way to access the data in the backend is via HTTP. So this is sort of when you write the plugin, you have some parts in Angular, some parts in JavaScript, and the data source, as I said, has to be accessed via HTTP. So can I connect Angular directly to MongoDB? There's a question on this on Stack Overflow. First answer was no, try using CouchDB. Apparently, this was not an option because data was in MongoDB. Second one, no, it's not possible. So what I need, because I cannot do this, I need something in between. So and this was my task to develop it. And I didn't want to dive deep into the Angular stuff. So Grafana provides a simple JSON data source out of the box. It's also kind of an example data source for when you want to build your own custom data sources. And there's three endpoints, search, annotations, and queries, or requests, three endpoints on the backend service. The first two are rather simple. I just want to walk right through them. Like, you send a request, send me target that match the string, sort of, and returns an array of metrics. So you can, for each graph, you have a label on it. Second one is a bit more complicated. It's specify a range in which you want to show annotations. And annotations like are markers on a specific time. It's also not that interesting. The more interesting one is the query one, where you do query the actual data. And you specify the range again. You have the number of data points, the resolution. And as a result, you get an array containing a value and the timestamp. So that's our time series here. So the goal was to provide the data source, a data source service that provides me these information here. So this was the structure that the client had, and has some metadata in it. And here were the actual measurements. Like, we have the timestamp and the number. The structure of this data is not well optimized for time series data. There's a very good webinar from MongoDB itself, how you should structure documents to store time series data in MongoDB. The reason is this is one document. So when I query time series data in the database, and let's say for the last hours, and I have 100,000 time points in this 1 hour, it returns me 100,000 documents, which is quite a lot. So the recommendation for MongoDB is to sort of pre-aggregate data and put them together. Sort of, we have an array where each field is like a minute and the hour. And in this array itself can contain another array for each second and so on. And in each of those values, you have pre-aggregated data. So you only retrieve one document, or probably one field of the document, which is much more efficient. But anyway, this was the data I had to work with. So next step was to develop the custom data source. It should be lightweight, fast, performant, quite simple. Didn't want to build something big. So a microservice sounds reasonable. There are several options for implementation. Java EE-based one, like Whitefly Swarm, Spring Boot, Vertex, and of course Node.js. I looked at the alternative options. Node.js is only single-threaded. You can spawn child worker processes when you want to do some more processing, but these processes are rather heavyweight. You have only JavaScript for implementation. When you do want to use another language, you're out of luck. And when you want to do some computational stuff, it's not the best choice to do. The other one, Spring or Java EE, both had a multi-threaded architecture, so we can do processing in parallel. It's clusterable, it's Java only most. And there are solid workhorses, but can be cumbersome at times. And my experience for both is the build and startup time is for what I try to achieve, is rather big overhead, even though there are microservice frameworks. So I had a look into Vertex. I heard about this framework before. Who of you has heard of Vertex before? Okay, some, good. Vertex is high performance, has a low memory footprint, requires only a few dependencies, is polyglot and scalable. So, but before we start into diving how I did implement this with Vertex, some basics about Vertex in general. Vertex is a library for asynchronous, non-blocking, reactive, polyglot microservice. If you ever played buzzword bingo, you've won now. And I'm stepping now through each of those and explain what they are in comparison to the traditional way. So asynchronous versus synchronous. Any one of you ever used these machines? It's a ticket dispenser. You pull a ticket, and you have a number. Yeah, and in Switzerland they used at the post office, or in Germany at the unemployment office, sort of thing. Is it asynchronous or synchronous? It's actually asynchronous, because it decouples the order of the queue from standing in the queue. You pull a number, and then you can do something else, reading a book, and from time to time look whether your number is already on the display or not. The opposite is this one. And if you have ever been in such a queue, you know it's pretty synchronous. So I have a request on the counter, and I step into the queue and wait and wait and wait. And if I ever get off the queue, you lost your place. So this is asynchronous. You can make better use of your time than just standing there. Apparently, you know this one. Is it non-blocking or blocking? If the capacity is too low, yeah, that's true. But in general, it's non-blocking. So it's a concept for providing or managing the access on a shared resource. The shared resource is the space where the two roads intersect. That's a shared resource. And whenever you come here and there's enough capacity in the roundabout, you can enter it and drive in whatever direction you want to go. I was in Paris, sort of the capital of roundabouts, and I was very afraid how I will manage without building an accident. And a former colleague of mine said, there are two rules. First one, don't drive into another one's car. So look ahead, don't make an accident yourself, and just drive in the direction you want to go. Don't worry about the others, because if everyone sticks to these rules, you find your way to your goal and don't build an accident. So, and this is sort of very non-blocking, so I can just drive slowly, but I can drive. This is the blocking alternative, and you know there are traffic lights, it's like a semaphore, and only one direction gets access to the shared resource. Next one is reactive. And I like this table tennis play here, because it contains everything what reactive is. They are very responsive. If they were not responsive, they would simply miss the ball. They are resilient, so they can counter attacks, so like jumping to the other place and hitting the ball, jumping this, stepping forward, stepping backward, and so on. They are very elastic, so they can play faster or slower, especially when you have ever seen professional table tennis players, is awesome what they can do. And it's message driven, and the message is actually the ball. So they only do something when the ball comes to them. So the opposite is this one. it's none of these, actually. So what is polyglot? Probably you've seen this one, the Star Trek communicator, and it translates any language that the bearer hears into their own native language, so they can understand it, responds to them, and this universal communicator translates back to the other one's language. So it can run multiple languages on the same machine, and this is kind of the virtual machine that translates the programming calls to the underlying architecture. This one is sort of the opposite. They only speak meh, and you cannot change this language, and if you cannot speak this language, you're out of luck. So like this C or assembler sort of thing. Microservice, again, you have a tool for every specific problem domain. And the monolith, you have all solutions in one big pile of code. So these are the basic characteristics what Vertex sort of provides you. All the stuff on the left side we've seen. Now some concepts of Vertex itself. Vertex is it's just a library. It's not they call themselves a library, not a framework. They are kind of unopinionated, and they have some concepts inside them. One of these are the verticals. These verticals contain your processing code, and they provide an actor-like concurrency. So in traditional Java environments, you have thread-based concurrency. So threads are kind of an abstraction on the hardware level sort of thing. So it can model concurrent code. And when two threads try to access a shared resource, they have to coordinate this access. In actor-like concurrency, you don't model this concurrent execution. You model messages that are sent between actors. So one actor like me or the other guy, we do things in parallel, and I send him a message, and he says, okay, I do it, and send you a message, and so on. So by this, you can model concurrency as well. It's the same principle behind the Akka framework of Scala. In Vertex, it's slightly different, but in general, it's the same principle. And also, the verticals are unit of deployment. Nevertheless, Vertex doesn't force you to write verticals. You can may use them, but you can just use the other aspects of Vertex, which is one of this is the event loop. If you have ever done gaming development, you probably know the concept of event loops. You have like a while loop, and you read events from the input device, from the keyboard, mouse, whatever. Then you update your model, re-render the scene, and start all over again. And this is pretty much the same in Vertex. So you have several verticals deployed on one event loop. They can send a message, which is just another event. And also, I/O events like network, database access, file access are also kind of events, and they are distributed to the verticals running on the same event loop. What's special in the event loop, each event loop runs on one thread. And you have not 100 event loops, but a rather limited one. And by this, you can execute, wait a second, multiple verticals after another, running on the same thread. The advantage is you don't have to do context switching on the processor. So they don't have to switch context to another thread. They can stay in the same thread context, which is much more efficient than switching between, let's say, 200 threads or something. Any one of you have seen this before or know what it is? We had one at our university. It is in continuous elevator. So one direction goes up, one direction goes down, and just step in, go down, and like this one. So you could think of the verticals like floors on the architecture, and when you, as the message, want to get from one floor to another floor, so sending a message to the third floor, you step into the paternoster, that's actually it's called, and drive up to the third floor, and then you get out again. And as you probably could see, all these boxes here in the elevator are your capacity of your event loop. So you cannot send more event messages at the same time than fit into the boxes. In Java, those boxes are rather a lot of boxes. So, but this is like your model concurrency. So you can send one message, another message, another message, and they are processed by this vertical, this vertical, and so on. So that's your concurrency. Of course, there are rules. Don't block the event loop. So here, the event loop is blocked, so it cannot access this one. This also happens to not only Node.js, but also to Vertex. When you have a processing that does some blocking operation or takes quite some time, everything that's running on this particular event loop is blocked from execution because one vertical doesn't give up its kind of processing time from the thread. But we come to this later, right after the next slide. Another concept is the event bus. This is how verticals communicate with each other. They put an event on the event bus, and each vertical can register itself at a specific address or multiple addresses to react on messages received. So send a message to some of the address, and the event bus distributes it to another vertical. Yeah, I have a good example of what an event bus also is like a pipe mail. Probably you've seen it once before. Wait a second, where's my mouse? Is that my mouse? Now there's some sound, but it's not. So this is here your event bus, and this vertical doesn't get it. There is no vertical. Please doesn't get it either. Wow. Okay, it's something. Finally, the receiver gets it. Yeah. I'm not affiliated with hiding it, simply like this spot, so nevertheless. What's also special on the Vertex is unlike Node.js, where you only have one event loop, Vertex has by default two event loops per CPU core. On a four-core machine, you have eight event loops. And when you deploy a vertical on the event loops, they are distributed sort of evenly. So when you deploy eight verticals, you have sort of guarantee that all the verticals run on a separate event loop. When you deploy, let's say, 16, probably each event loop contains then two verticals, for instance. But this works out pretty well. Another very interesting one is the event loop, the event bus is can be extended to other instances of virtual machines running on other physical machines. And by this view, you form a cluster. So you can easily send one message from one vertical on one virtual machine to another vertical on another virtual machine. And it's all handled transparently in the background. I think the default cluster manager is Hazelcast. Yeah. Other option is to extend it to the browser using a WebSocket. It's also handled transparently. So you can have some JavaScript code in the browser that receives the message and sort of updates the UI or whatever. So what's also different to Node.js, you know, not only have verticals running on one event loop, but you also have traditional thread pool-based workers if you need them. You can create a worker thread pool, and this is very classic. You can run blocking code in there. So also when you write your verticals and you have some aspects of blocking, said, OK, I want to run it blockingly, and then it uses a dedicated worker thread pool. Right, now we start with the data source. Okay, back to our initial problem. What we need, now that we know what verticals are, we need an HTTP vertical that provides our endpoint receiving the HTTP requests, and they route the requests to one of the processing verticals. And one we definitely need is one that does the querying on the database. Searching time series labels and annotations, the interesting one is the one that searches the actual time series. And optional, you can do some post-processing on it. When you want to do some computational heavy stuff, you have dedicated verticals for those. So the challenge on all this is the optimization. You can optimize queries. You have to search large data sets. They need to be searched, read, transported. And how do we optimize all this process to limit the data in transportation, so keep the pressure on the resources low? And also, the customer, I had the problem, I couldn't modify the data source, so I had to stick with this shitty model data source or data set versus data redundancy, sort of copying into a different form that is better optimized for querying. And also, the sizing question. How do I size the system when I don't know how long the queries will take, how many thread pools, how many memory, and so on. So first one, analyzing data from the database. So this is sort of our system, the CPU. We have the event bus and the HTTP vertical receiving the request. Then we send a message to the time series vertical. This one does a querying and returns the response back to the requester. You have specific verticals for labels and the annotation. They have their own kind of responsibility. So, okay, step one, find all data points within range. The naive approach. Naive approach is we just send from to query. And first, probably let's show you how simple vertex can be if it's, you don't see it at all. That's kind of sad, just don't see it. Yeah, don't see it either. It's so good. Yeah, there you go. So I created just a simple class, then a main method, then I start the vertex instance. There you go. This already contains the system for the event loops. And now I can, let's say, I want to register a consumer on the event bus, listening on the address. This is just an opaque string. I hope you can read it. Can you read it? Yeah. Good, great. And when we receive the message, we want to simply print them out. Message body. So now we have event loop, we have the event bus, and now we send a message. Event bus send to test hello world. Oh. So, now execute it. Hopefully you see it down there. Yeah. There you have the output. So as simple as that. Now we want to create an abstract vertical or vertical. Just extend the abstract vertical. Now we deploy this vertical either by name, or we can pass the instance here as well. Abstract vertical provides classes for initialization. And we create a HTTP server. Create HTTP server. There you go. Then we need a router. So we define a route, like get hello, and have a handler that receives the response, context, response, and code Europe. So now we defined what we want to do when we receive a GET request on this URL. Now we have to start the server. Request handler, which is the router, accept, listen on port 8080, and so when we are done, succeeded, we complete the start future. Let's So that's it. That's our HTTP server. There's something missing. So okay. Now we start it again. It's running. I don't produce any output there. But I have now this localhost. 8080 hello. There you go. Pretty straightforward. So now back to our data source. I prepared the one. This is the simple Grafana data source. Here you see I deploy only this data source here. Sorry. So I read some configuration. I deploy this vertical, which is kind of my master. And this one deploys all the other needed verticals. The label vertical for querying the labels, annotation vertical, the HTTP server, and this one here does our actual querying in the database. We can look into this one as well. Here I read the Mongo configuration, create a Mongo client. It's also a part of Vertex already. Here set the query URL, and and this part here, this is kind of not so nice to read, I create a query for the MongoDB database, which I at some point, here, this is the find operation. I don't want to go too much in detail how I've written this because it looks very ugly in Java. And this does the actual query to the database. MongoDB is already running. I think so, at least. MongoDB. I started it before, there it is. So. So this is our MongoD process. And so this is our data source. I prepared some graphs already. This is some data from the test set. So now I run the query and, wait a second, it shouldn't show you anything because I haven't started it. So now it started, it's listening already, great. So I can just rerun the query. And it's interesting now. It Didn't take too long. Wait a second, I can... This data set from the beginning is sort of 1.5 years of data ending in October, November sort of thing, doesn't matter. Apply. So now it runs again. And what's interesting here is the database only uses 14% of CPU, and it takes quite a while. As you could see, the spinner here is still circling, and we're waiting for the data. And so from performance analysis, what we could see in this graph here, this red is all system calls, like I/O, for instance. And so the database is reading the data from the disk now, but it doesn't make good use of the CPU, does it? It's actually only using one core because we only sent one single query. So it's still running. I think we run into a timeout something. Yeah. Query. No, we haven't received any response yet, apparently. It still takes a while. I think it takes up to a minute or something. And now we received some data. Yeah, here, 50 seconds it took. 50 seconds for both queries. What you can see as well, I sent two queries. One for the upper graph, one for the lower one. Each one took 50 seconds. And we didn't make good use of our CPU here. So back to our approach here. So the naive approach was not very, very performant. Took us around a minute to search 1 year. It's quite long. So this was our architecture I've showed you, basically. So next one is split the request. So I have eight cores on the CPU, so I could split it up to eight chunks to keep MongoDB more busy. Right. So I have a time range, and create the chunks on this time range, and send all the chunks in parallel, which is also kind of interesting when you have multiple database servers in a sharding configuration, so you can send requests to each of the shards. So the architecture, we have an additional vertical here that splits our requests, and then sends to our simple one we used already eight requests downstream, which are then responded by the database and back to the data source of Grafana. So back to this one. Stop it. So here we do deploy again our simple time series vertical, but now we have this one. And what I did in this options here, I said, okay, run it on a different address. So this split merge vertical will receive the query request, then split it up and send it to the simple one we used right now. And after that, responses return. They are put back together into one big response that is sent to Grafana. So run. So it started. So again, create. So then I see a much better utilization of CPU just by sending eight concurrent queries to the database. It will still take a while because there are quite a lot of data points, which we also see in the response down here. So first responses already came in. Yeah, OK, these are responses for our two queries. Hopefully you can see it. The first query was answered after 24 seconds, the second one also after 24 seconds, and we received quite a lot of data points, like 100,000 data points and so on. So way too much that Grafana actually needs. If you remember, the request was retrieve me 1,900 data points or so. We got much more data than we actually needed. So, been here. Right. So, next one is we use the MongoDB aggregation pipeline to reduce the data points that are returned from the database to the data service. Who of you knows MongoDB, by the way? Some? Any one of you used the aggregation pipeline? I'll show you. So what we do is reduce these numbers to this. And again, but now we just send a different query that aggregates the data in the database and return them back to our service. Again, out of here. Don't need those. So here we have your aggregation time series vertical, and I jump into them. So again, Mongo. And this is what an aggregation pipeline in Mongo will look like. You have an array with several JSON documents in that array. It's now on, and it's in comment, which have several operations like match the name and the begin. So you have your time query for it, then group them together using some aggregation method like building the average, the sum, min, max value, and so on. And whoever tried to write JSON in Java, it's a pain in the ass. I created some factory method to make it a bit more readable, but behind each of those calls is like a new object, new object, new object, and it's already in that stage kind of unreadable. It works, but it's really a mess. And there comes into play that I could use a different language in Vertex, let's say JavaScript, which is kind of natural. And I've written the actual same vertical here in JavaScript. Here we have the configuration from the vertical, the address, create the Mongo client, the event bus, get the message. And here we build our aggregation pipeline. And this here looks much more natural. This is our pipeline here, our array. And this is pretty the same syntax you would use in MongoDB directly. So we have the match, end, in, and so on. Very easy to write. You can copy and paste this code directly into Mongo shell and execute it, and it just works. So our data source now looks like this. Here we deploy our JSON vertical, JavaScript vertical, and reuse the other verticals we already had. So I can mix Java verticals or Java code with JavaScript code, and Vertex does everything for me, which is pretty convenient. So now let's execute this one. So now it started. I started it in cluster mode, which the reason I will show you in a couple of seconds. So we have one member here in the cluster already. Yeah, so back to our system here. Run the query. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this was around 10 seconds or something. And now we received aggregated results. And let's look how long it take. Yeah, 8 seconds for the second one, and 7 seconds for the first one. And I think, do we see how many values were returned? No, we don't. Okay, so we have much less data here. We can now zoom in, sort of thing, let's run the query again. There, I got our data. And now we're getting somewhere, right? Unfortunately, we won't get any faster than this. So the data is not optimized for this. So without optimizing the data structure itself, it won't get any faster. Yes. Right. Okay. Let's zoom out again. So I told you that I run it in cluster mode, and I come to the next one. I have also in the slide how to calculate percentiles, like 90% percentile, and so on. And a very naive approach would be fetch all the data and calculate them in Java, which just take ages. Using like Apache Commons math or something. But you can do it also in the database, which is much more faster calculating them. The source code is on GitHub, you can look it up. I will skip this because of time reasons. But the next one, what's interesting is once we have this data, we can do some post-processing, like doing some extrapolation or combining it with other data. And how would our architecture look like? So we have our verticals, our actors, receiving the messages. And once we returned or received the result from the database, which I just for that it becomes clear, I just split those two aspects up of the same vertical. Once we receive the response from the database, we could send them to post-processing verticals, running on a different virtual machine, probably a more powerful physical machine that has more computational power. And the message is sent over the event bus to the other verticals and then returned and back to the Grafana client, for instance. Okay, I already have my data source right now. I'm running, receiving a request for the aggregation, you know, and now I start an additional JVM providing exactly these post-processing data. And what this one does, let me check. When it started, right. When it started up and loaded the data, it's actually it's reading data file containing Bitcoin historical Bitcoin values. It takes roughly 20 seconds to load it entirely into memory. Once it's done, it sends a message to this address saying, okay, I am reachable on this address. And the other one has like a hook receiving, listening on that address here. And said, okay, I know there's a post processor, so I can use one when I have the data. So all is working sort of transparently in the background. So we start this one. And here we see, okay, they found each other. They automatically built a cluster. So I have now two virtual machines running. I can show you here, this is Visual VM. We have our JavaScript-based aggregate data source. This one here. And we have the other one for the Bitcoin data. So, right. Now I run it again, the query. And what it now does, it adds an additional time series with multiplies the results with the Bitcoin value at the same date. And yeah, it's just for fun in this case. So when you said, okay, time is money sort of thing, at this time would be really bad if we have slow tests sort of thing. Just for fun. But what I tried to show you how such an architecture could look like. How do I define the actors of my actor-based system to analyze the data, apply some post-processing on it. Yes. Back to this one. Right. Okay, we've done this. So some advices. Try to push calculations to the database if possible, because it limits the amount of data that is transmitted to the data source. Makes it much more faster. You can add more worker nodes or more physical nodes or additional virtual machines for more complex post-processing, and also try to aggregate the results before do post-processing. All kind of strategies to limit the amount of processing you have to do to make it more faster, more reactive sort of thing. And of course, you need a strong database server. My bottleneck here on this machine is actually my machine for running the MongoDB, which is running locally right now. If I had a cluster, for instance, with several shards, it would also be much faster. So next one, analyzing data from a file. And this one I came up with, this additional vertical I brought up, which was reading the Bitcoin data, takes around, I said, 20 seconds to start up to read the entire data into memory. The data file itself is around 1.4 gigabytes. So probably you have at some point you have to analyze a large data or lots of large data files, which you probably cannot read entirely into memory. Or if you want to read them into memory, you want to do it really fast. So what should the data look like? So in this case, the Bitcoin data file contains on every line a data point with a timestamp, the Bitcoin value, and the Bitcoin volume, I think, at this point. But you're only interested in the value. The first characters are timestamped, data set. What's important, the data set is sorted. If it's unsorted, you are out of luck. But if the data set is sorted, you can optimize the query. And what's also kind of it's not that important, but good to know, that is they are not equally distributed. So we have probably in 1 hour 100,000 points, and next hour 10, sort of thing. So, and Grafana requires 1,900 data points per request. So as said before, how to either randomly access 1,900 data points without reading their entire file into memory, or how to read a huge file efficiently into memory, of course you need an index. Who of you ever built an index before? None? Me neither. So that was my first time. And it's not that complicated. From study, we know, from computer science study, we know that indexes can be used by built by using a data structure like a binary tree, and red-black tree is a very efficient binary tree. It provides log n time complexity for reading stuff. So, you know, this is kind of typical interview questions, build a red-black tree. I've never built a red-black tree in my life before. And I don't do it for this time as well, because Java has already one. And this is the tree map. And actually, I think that since Java 7, some update from Java 7, since then, all hash map-based maps are red-black tree implementations. So also, Java util hash map is a red-black tree. But tree map provides another nice feature, which is you can have special methods to find the, when you search for a key and the key is not existent, you can find the next higher one or next lower one, which is really good for querying the data. So how do we build the index? At first, when we start the service, we just scan over the file, and we do it by jumps. We start here, scan this chunk, so OK, I know this timestamp at this offset position is XYZ. Then we jump, let's say, 10 megabytes and read the timestamp on this position, and over again. And by this, we put them all the offset positions into a tree map, so we know when we look for timestamp 1, it gives me an offset of 1, and we look for timestamp 100,000, it gives me an offset of 10, for instance. So by this, we can locate the position on the disk quite fast. So when we, on the next query, we refine the index. OK, we need more details in the index, so we send another request and fill in the additional offset positions, and the red-black tree is balanced automatically. So data source architecture again. Pretty much the same, only difference here is we use the read file to post-processing and stuff like this. And I want to show you this as well. This is the last demo. And of course I don't know what's wrong here. The index point. Come on. Yeah, it really has some issues to find this. I don't know what's wrong with IntelliJ here. It doesn't find this field, but hopefully it. Yeah, right. So okay, now you read the data points. 85,000 data points in 2 seconds, which is rather fast comparing to the 20 seconds we had before. And now go to this one. And now we see here it reads the data, processed all the chunks of it with some entries. And here we have our data points. This is now the Bitcoin data file I have locally, and now I can quite fast query the data here. What's also interesting, when we have the let's look at the memory consumption here. This here on top right, this memory consumption. It's now at 74 megabytes, so I didn't read the entire file into memory, and it requires even less. Resident memory is like 40 megabytes, which one-third of it is the index I created. And I can very fast just scan to the file, zoom out again. And the system, you know, doesn't do much here. So I can even do quite a lot of reloads. It's very responsive, very fast. I was also kind of surprised how fast it actually was. I mean, it's an SSD, I have to say as well. So no magnetic disk. Magnetic disk would be much slower. Yeah. Okay. That's about it. And I think I'm also through with the talk. When creating the file size, you have some configuration things like block size, index size, startup time. You have to balance what works best for you. So takeaways, Vertex is reactive, non-blocking, asynchronous, scalable, and it's good for buzzword bingo. It's running on JVM, polyglot, very fun to work with. So the documentation is very good, community is very good. A lot of working examples. It's pretty fun for dealing with it, especially when you come from the Java world. And when you do want to do data processing, it's a very valid choice. Thank you.